In the last class, we started like thinking about how to go ahead and solve this stochastic linear bandit, right? So we just said, okay, so we just said first thing we are going to do is, first question is how to estimate the parameter theta. So what did you say, how you are going to estimate it? What was the natural candidate for this estimation? How did we get an estimate for theta stars? We already discussed, right? We are going to just regularize least square methods. We are going to do this. Okay. So estimate least squares. And what is the second part? We assume that we will be able to find confidence sets in every round such that my theta star belongs to that that confidence set with high probability. It is so now the first part is easy, right? We already know, like, given my observations, how to find an estimate of theta. We'll just do the regularized least square method. And then the main question was, here we said how to find this confidence interval so that my theta star belongs to this confidence set with high probabilities. In the last class we said that we are going to write, let's assume my confidence set to be some subsets of the form such that so for some beta sequence. We said that suppose I will be able to give such sets based on my estimate till round t minus 1, and if I construct such a ball, let's say this ball includes my theta star with high probability. So all I have not yet specifying how this beta star all defined. Of course, they will maybe depend on this theta itself. That, sorry, delta itself, with what confidence you want your theta star to belong to this. In addition, this beta t may also depend on all the observations you have made so far, all the arms you have played and the corresponding rewards you have observed so far. So how we will get this, we will look into that later. But now let's say you are able to do this. Now what is the method to find out how you go about finding regret of my stochastic linear bandit? So how did we define regret of my stochastic linear bandit? It is RT of pi. We said this as summation minus whatever the arm you played, and then this is theta. So this is what you are going to obtain in round t, right? So if I are going to play arm dt in round t, this is the mean reward you would have got. Actually, what you have observed in round t is we have denoted it as the reward you are going to, reward sample you are going to observe is this quantity plus an eta term, which we say conditionally sub Gaussian. Right, so this is the noisy reward you are going to observe in round T, and we have defined your regret to be like this. And here we want to bound this quantity and also the expected value of this quantity. So here it is still this DTs, the arm you are going to play in every round could be random, right? Because the choice of this DT depends on what you have observed so far, and that depends on what are the sets DT that has been selected so far. Okay. Okay, fine. So now how to go about this? Before we start proving that, we are going to make couple of more assumptions about this setup. First thing we are going to assume is that the reward, the mean reward, so this is the mean reward, right, in round T. We know that this is a sub Gaussian, so this is a noise with mean 0. So the mean reward you are going to get in round T is this. We are going to say that this is going to be always less than or equals to 1 for all D coming from DT T equals to T. What does this mean? In round T, this is DT is going to be a decision set, right? Consider all union of all this decision set. It is saying that you play any element from this decision, all possible decisions, the mean reward for that is always bounded by 1. So this is same as saying that earlier the mean value of my bandit of each arms is less than 1. So the analog version of the mean here is this quantity here, right? It is just we are saying that mean is going to be, which irrespective of which arm here you are going to play, here arms are nothing but the decision vectors, right, decision points. Whichever you are going to play, for that you are going to get the mean reward, which is strictly less than or equals to 1. The second, and we are going to assume that the elements D are all bounded with L2 norm. Again, for all D belongs to
at the maximum.
No, the maximum reward is this. So in round T, right, DT is your decision set. If you have whatever that D that maximizes this, if you have played that D, that is the maximum reward you are going to
get.
That
D will also belong to the union of all decision sets.
No, this D is coming, you are going to choose this D only from DT.
Yeah, but that D will also belong to the union of all decision sets.
Yes, it belongs to.
So you said that the mean is bounded by 1, but all those values are bounded by 1 actually.
See, the reward is given like this, right? The reward is this part, if you are going to play in round T, some decision T plus noise. So this is the, what is the mean reward you are going to get in round T? This is nothing but this part, right? Depending on which arm you played. I am just saying that whichever arm you are going to play in that round, or in fact any round, in for all those rounds, the mean value should be less than or equals to 1. Okay. What is what you are saying? DT is why it is probabilistic, because this is what you are going to observe, right, in every round. So let's say till some point time you have observed, you know which is the arm you are going to play, and you know what is the corresponding reward you observed. So this is the information you have, And any estimate you are going to make, it is going to depend on these two quantities, right? It has to depend on the observation you have made that is noisy. And because of that, any next decisions you are going to make. So okay. So let's say, how did we find theta t hat? We said that this is nothing but r min of, this is my r t minus, and then what did we say? What d t of theta square plus norm of theta square, right? So this is what is it? This is what our regularized least square regression, regularize the least square estimate, right? Whatever theta t hat you are going to find, this should be, maybe I should write it as s equals to 1 to t minus 1. So till round t, you have observed all the samples from s to t minus 1. You have observed this reward and the corresponding, for this corresponding arm ds, you got this. Now the decision which arm you are going to play in the next round has to depend on this, right? Based on these estimates, I am going to make a decision which arm I am going to play in the next round. So I will come to that. Let me write this conditions under which I am going to prove this. Okay. So this is one assumption. This is assumption, and then the third assumption is simply this. Like in every round, so this theta star belongs to CT for all t with high probability. This is another assumption I am going to make. Okay. Now. Okay. Fine. This is the setup. Now I have to give you an algorithm, how the generic algorithm looks like, and then I am going to say for that algorithm how the regret bounds are going to look like. Okay, fine. You estimate your theta in round t based on your past observations like this. So this theta hat is a random quantity, right? So now based on using this, or maybe like in round t based on your previous estimate, you are going to, whatever in round, you are going to construct a confidence set like this. Okay, now let's see how to find, now how to make a decision in every round based on this information. So now I have to make a decision, right? So this, in every round I have to see a DT set is revealed to me. Looking into that DT set, I have to now decide which is the small DT from that set I'm going to play. How you are going to do that? Suppose if I can assign a value to each element in the decision set DT, okay, then what I will do? So okay, so let's go back to my multi-arm bandit setting, the original one. What we did, for each arm based on its estimate plus the confidence term, I defined a value for each arm, right? So in my in my standard, I have mu t hat plus 2 log t divided by n. So this is my estimate of arm I till round, let us say t minus 1, and this is my number of pulls of this. So I have defined a term like this for arm I, and what I did, I played an arm which has this highest value, right? So this is kind of a index value that I assign to arm I. Now for me, the arms are this entire set. Okay. So first, suppose if I can assign a index value to each of the elements in this set DT, then which is the arm you are going to play in that round T? So, okay, so what is this? So, we said that this is nothing but UCB of arm I, and what I did, I basically played an arm which has the highest value of this UCB quantity, right? I am going to do possibly similar thing. Maybe when I set DT is revealed to you, do a similar thing. For every point in that, define a UCB index for that. And then go and find out which is the point arm in that which has the highest UCB index, right? So now let's worry about how to find this UCB index. Now this is for multi bandit. So now I have to find UCB for a D in round T. So I have DT. Now for all D belongs to DT, I need to find UCB of D. Okay. So let me write it more clearly. So one natural candidate is to find and assigning a UCB value to each element in this is to look for how, okay, let me define this and then we will discuss, is equals to max over theta belongs to Ct times d theta. See what I have defined? This Ct is something which involves my true parameter with high probability. In a way, this Ct is some ball which involves my d star, sorry, my theta star with high probability. Now, what I am doing? For my arm D, I am looking for, suppose if I have to play this arm D, now I am looking at the best reward I would have got if the parameter theta is drawn from this set Ct, is right. So what I am basically assuming is my true parameter is somewhere in this, all I know is it is somewhere in this. All I am trying to do is, I am trying to take this UCB index, the best value I would have obtained if I played, so the best that could have happened to me if I played my arm D. So this is what, right, like I am basically choosing the reward for D optimistically. So how we did it in the UCB? UCB, we have a mu hat, and then around this mu hat we have constructed the confidence interval, right? And what would I do? I always went and choose this as the true index. This as the index for my arm, and then I define the UCB index to be. So I am trying to do similar thing here. In this ball, I am just trying to see. So if I will just compute, take my x d, just see if with this d, what is the theta that gives me maximum value in the set Ct that I am going to define the UCB index of that arm D. That is just like thinking that with my current information of confidence set, I am just assuming that optimistically the parameter is the best possible one when I'm going to, I mean, when I'm going to, if I'm going to play arm D, I'm going to see that the parameter that is unknown to me is the best that could have come from CT. I don't know what is that parameter, but from this CT, I'm just going to do this maximization and assign UCB to be this value. So do you agree that this is like assigning the value to D optimistically here from this set CT? Earlier I was doing this optimistically by just adding this upper confidence bound. Here also in a way analogously I am doing some kind of upper confidence bound, right? The best I could have got from this set D if I have to play arm D. So this is how we are going to define UCB index of arm D. Once I have defined UCB index of arm D like this, then what I am going to do? Find the one which is going to maximize that. Then you are going to do play R max over D of UCB of D. And this is what we are going to call it as DT star DT. So this is the one I am going to play. So this is basically my algorithm. So you see that this is nothing but again applying the UCB idea, upper confidence bound idea, to this contextual settings where I have not finitely many arms, but that arm set is now a complete set DT which could have uncountably many elements in this, okay. But now that I have that parameterized it, right? So I have parameterized the rewards and now I am trying to estimate this parameter and building a confidence about that parameter using the CT, and now I have defined my confidence, upper confidence for each my arm in this fashion. Okay, fine. This is the broad idea that all the algorithms that work in, that apply on linear stochastic bandits work, okay. And there are different names like the based on how they are going to come up with this confidence sets. So in literature you will see many algorithms like Lin UCB, it is called linear UCB, there are other called I think Lin REL. So this is like Lin UCB stands for linear stochastic bandits UCB. Lin REL stands for I think linear reinforcement learning. This is one of the earlier algorithm, okay. And there is another algorithm that is more recent. It is called optimism in the face of uncertainty. L stands for linear, okay. So people have this different algorithms on this. So all of them are going to hinge on kind of this. They just differ in terms of how they are going to construct these confidence sets. So okay, yeah.
The assumptions. So I mean, what of the complexity of the problem is simply taken away by the assumptions that we are making?
These assumptions?
Yes.
No, in fact, these assumptions are not actually, I mean, bad. What is this? This is just about the setup, right? What we are basically missing? We are just saying mean rewards are bounded by 1. If they are not,
I'm talking about the C part. Does that belong to CT?
Yes, yes, of course. This is the more complex part. Now later we will see that how to construct such sets. Right? Because right now if you have begun starting by how to construct that set, I mean we will lose the overall picture, right? So right now I am saying that let's say we have such a sets, then how to go about this algorithm, okay. So now you will see that even with this setup to bound my regret, I need to have a slightly different, take a different approach than what I had done for the standard bandit algorithm. So how did we do? How did we prove the regret for our multi-arm bandits in the standard setup? We basically bounded the number of pulls of suboptimal arm, right? And how we were able to do that? We know that if you have to play total number of rounds T, of course each one of has to be played less than that many rounds T. But here the number of arms itself could be countably many or uncountable, right? The number of arms. So because of this, it may happen that you may not even end up playing some of the arms. So, what in the standard multi-arm bandit setting, you played each arm at least once, right? That there were only finitely many arms and your time horizon, you always took larger than to be than number of arms, you got at least one samples. But here, if once T is finite, even though this set DT, let's say it is going to same in every round, it may happen that for some of the arms you will never get any observation. Okay, so because of that, like, it's not clear that the same method we use to bound the number of rounds, number of plays of the suboptimal arm is going to work out here. Okay, so that's why, let's see, if we have this, what is the way to go and probe through the bound? Yeah, but now this, that has been now gotten into this set D. Now this is what I am going to call as arms.
All values that are possible in DT.
Yes, all values possible in DT. Okay, so let's rewind this. What is DT for us? Let's now go back to our initial problem from where we arrived at it here. So DT for us is nothing but phi of xt of a coming from k, right? So in round t, a feature x, a context xt was revealed, and I had a map, feature map, which said for each action what is this value.
This was for contextual bandits. For the linear bandits, you generalize this even more to,
right? So this is what, like, this is the contextual bandit. Now I am just saying that this set DT consists of these features. This cardinality is finite. So now, if by making it more general, this CT DT could be any arbitrary subset, bounded subset. Okay. The thing here is, so where did this, each of this feature remained in? This is a feature vector, right? This remained in some RD space. Now instead of that, let's say why always talk about these specific features. I'm just saying in every round I'm going to get a set DT which will consist of this feature vectors, and those feature vectors I'm going to call this arm. It's a subset of RDS. Yes. Yeah, that's what, like, this DT is a bounded subset of RD. Okay. So other way to think about this is, so in this case it is clear that there are only finitely many features, right, in this, because one corresponding to each arm. So let it, the number of arms goes to infinity. Or like number of arms is could be uncountable. Then for each arm I have this feature space, right? And that I'm going to now call it as DT. But each feature vector is corresponding to one particular arm, right? So that is why now, because we have done this abstraction, I'm now just saying that any element in this DT is corresponds to an arm. Okay. So when I have done this, if I take a particular element here, phi of xt and a, that corresponded to that arm a, right? So I have basically for in that round t, I have mapped a arm to a feature. So here just like I have given so many features, that means I am just thinking that they correspond to different arms. We have not, that's why I have thrown away that concept of actual physical arms, and now we have these features of this decision space, and again I am coming back and saying every element in that decision space is another arm, it's just an arm.